Well, I'm excited today as we start this new series called Against the Grain. The idea is that as Christians, we're called to live different lives, to live lives that reflect Jesus but are different. They go against the grain. They go against what's norm in our culture, in our society. And so we're going to be talking about a lot of the issues that you saw in the video there, about poverty and wealth, about racism, about all of these kind of life and death issues, all of these serious cultural and social issues we're going to be talking about for the next 10 weeks. I got the idea from this series from a book that I read a couple years ago called Counterculture by David Platt. And initially I thought this would be kind of a good series to do and kind of talk about these topical things. Normally we don't spend a lot of time talking about topical issues like we just came off the first part of that series in Mark where we're going step by step through the Bible. This way we're going to be looking at how the Bible talks about some of these issues that we have to face and have to deal with in our culture. And how do we as Christians live in a world that's going in a direction that I believe is contrary to what God says in His Word. And so I'll be leaning heavy on that book during this series, and we're going to be talking about some of these ideas, these big picture kind of things, and understanding. And my hope is that you'll invite a lot of your friends and maybe share this on social media, share our live stream maybe, to get some of your friends maybe who are wondering, what is a Christian perspective on some of these issues, some of these things that we have to deal with time and time again in our world today? Now, as a quick word of warning, now this is a word of warning ahead of time. This is 10 weeks long. I want to tell you, there's going to be some times in this series where you think, Jonathan has lost his mind. He is not right. He's wrong. I think that what I've been taught is right and Jonathan is wrong. My hope is that I am not sharing with you Jonathan's opinion on these matters, right? So my hope and my goal and my desire is to do my best through study and understanding and listening to other Christian leaders and theologians to share with you God's viewpoint on some of these issues as best we can as human beings. Now, if I were just to say, here's my thoughts on God, that's one thing, but we're going to be looking at God's Word that the Holy Spirit wrote for us so that we can understand who God is, so we can have an understanding of who God is. But there's going to come some points, I'm almost certain, where some of you are going to think, he's wrong, he's lost his mind, I hope the elders fire him, and maybe it won't go that far, maybe not. But my hope is that if you get to that point where you think he can't be right here, then my hope is that you ask yourself the question, is God using Jonathan to challenge the way that I think? To make me think beyond kind of what I believe to be true. And if you begin to ask those questions, then this has been successful. Then we're going in a good direction, because sometimes we kind of get in this mindset where we have it down because this is how we've been taught, this kind of thing. And so this is just kind of the way it is. Now, when we talk about social issues in the church, issues of culture and society and social issues in the church, one of the struggles that leaders have, and Beth and I were just talking about this a few minutes ago, is there's a tension there, right? So on the one hand, a lot of Christian leaders are taught that you don't talk about these things, right? You talk about what the Bible says, you talk about the gospel, the good news of Jesus, and you let those kind of things work themselves out, right? So you tell the truth and you let everything else kind of work itself out. That's one viewpoint. Another viewpoint is kind of the opposite of that, where you talk about these things all the time, right? And so it's kind of like you just talk about these things and you love people and you hope that they work themselves out. It's kind of the either or. Either you are just about this or you're just about that. But I think that both of those viewpoints are extreme, and both of those viewpoints, in my opinion, are wrong. I think that it's a both and, that we can both talk about the truth about God and how He would call us to respond to these things and live in a certain way in the world where we're actually helping make a difference in this world. So I think it's not either or, it's both and. Last week we talked about the resurrection. Every Easter we're reminded. Hopefully we think about that more than every Easter. But every Easter we're absolutely reminded that the tomb is empty, which, by the way, it's still empty today, right? It doesn't have to be just empty on Easter. But we were reminded last week that the tomb is empty. And so as we gathered together, as a large group of people, we gathered together and we looked into the empty tomb. We gazed in there and we remembered that Jesus' body's not there. How wrong would it be for us as Christians to gaze into the empty tomb, realizing that the Savior's not there, and to turn and walk away and not do anything about it. Our hope, and my hope, is that we gaze into the empty tomb every single day. We remember that Jesus is not there. He has raised a new life. And then we turn and don't forget and do nothing about it. But we turn and walk and we begin to live lives as Christ followers, impacting the world around us. My hope is that as we go through this series, that I begin and we begin to think about these things. Think about how we can make a difference because the tomb is empty. I don't have to tell you that we live in a world where people get rich on the backs of those who are struggling and oppressed. I don't have to tell you that we live in a world where some people are going to look at you and they're going to determine your value simply based on the color of your skin. I don't have to tell you that we live in a world where every single day, every day, multiple times a day, we sacrifice our children to the God of ease and comfort, and we call it health care. We live in a world that needs help. And I believe that God has called the church, He's called us to step in and to make a difference. And the reason that I know that God thinks this way and feels this way is because in His Word, He's told us that He cares about justice. In fact, let me read for you a verse here from the psalmist in Psalm verse 89, reading in verse 14. The psalmist writes this. He writes, "Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne." He's talking about God. "Steadfast love and faithfulness go before you." And so what the psalmist is relaying to us, he's talking to God, but we get to hear, kind of sit in on his prayer, is that the very foundation of the throne of God is righteousness and justice. And so if we're going to be a people of God, then those things that matter to God ought to matter to us as well. If I keep going at this level, I'm going to lose my voice. My throat is... But I'm working hard. Can I hear you, right? And so the question is this. If God is for righteousness and justice, and Christianity is about being like God and following Him and being the kind of people that God calls us to be, then Christianity is also for justice and righteousness. If that's true, why are some people offended by a Christian worldview? Right? I mean, we when we think about that, we think that isn't everybody for righteousness and justice? But the answer is no. And so the question is, why not? And the answer starts with the shocking offense of the gospel. Thank you. I've mentioned this before, but the gospel itself, and the gospel, when I talk about the gospel, is the good news of Jesus. That Jesus lived and He died. He lived a perfect life. He died a horrific death. He rose from the dead so that everyone who turns and follows Him can be saved. That's good news. But by itself, the gospel is offensive. And beyond the offense, what's embraced in our lives, once we begin to say, okay, I understand that truth, I believe that truth, I'm going to live that truth, it ought to make a difference in our lives, how we think and how we act. David Platt in Counterculture said that the gospel compels Christians to confront issues and the culture around us. And because Christ changed us and is changing us, we're going to look at injustices in the world, not simply as something that shouldn't happen. Now, we're not going to watch the news and say, man, I wish that criminal hadn't have done that thing, or I wish that those kind of things didn't happen. But we're going to look at the world around us, we're going to see injustice, and we're going to recognize it as it is, as an offense against God. And as we grow into Christ's likeness, social justice, and social, especially as we think about injustice, it ought to lead us to a righteous indignation. When we see injustice in the world around us, it ought to make us angry to the point where we say, that can't be because that's not good and that's not of God. I was taught, I think, as a young person that anger was sinful. And maybe it was because I was a little bit angry as a young person, right? And anger can certainly be sinful, but anger itself doesn't have to be sinful. Jesus got incredibly angry when He entered the temple. And they had turned it into a kind of this money laundering scheme, right? And He goes in there in anger. He turns over the tables. He drives the people out with a whip. That's righteous. What he was doing was good and right in his anger, because what they were doing was an injustice. And so we ought to be like Jesus. When we see injustice in the world around us, it ought to drive us to a righteous indignation. And when we as Christians begin to act on that righteous indignation, then we're going to be confronting issues of injustice in the world around us. And I promise you that we're going to quickly become very unpopular. Depending on where you land on an issue or what issue or how you fall, the way our country is divided, you're probably going to get applauded by some and jeered by others. Because that's the way our culture is. So no matter what happens, as Christians, when we begin to fight injustice, we're going to become very unpopular. The biggest problem, and the one that hurts me the most, the one that I struggle with deeply, is not that Christians stand up for injustice. I am so glad when they do. But it's when Christians who stand up for injustice, who are changed by Jesus, those people who are changed by Jesus, who are living a Christian life, the gospel is compelling them to make a change. They see injustice and they get kind of a righteous anger, and they go out and they begin to change the world. The problem is not that they're hated by those who are outside, but the problem is, the one that I struggle with the most, is that so many Christians in the church are also going to be hating the person who's angry at the injustice in the world. I saw that this week. On May 27th, we're going to be talking about, May 27th, we're going to be talking about issues of race and racism. We have a special guest. I didn't say this at the beginning, but I wanted to say this. There's at least right now, as of right now, there are going to be four weeks during this series where we have special guests. I better not even say the dates or I'll mess them up. But coming up in 3 weeks for sure, we're going to have a lady coming in from an organization called Street Grace. And she's going to be talking to us and kind of trying to educate us on the reality of domestic minor sex trafficking. You talk about a powerful thing. She came in my office and talked to me this week. Wow, I was blown away. She gave me some information that just blew my mind. The stuff that's happening right here in our backyard. I hope that if you don't come to hear me, great, that's whatever. Definitely be here when we have guests, okay? On April 29th, May 27th, this is what I was trying to say. May 27th, we've got a lady here coming here to talk about race and how we deal with race and racism in our culture. She leads an organization called Grace Dialogues where they have educated church leaders on how to deal with issues and struggles as it relates to race. But this week, there was a conference called the MLK 50. It was honoring and remembering Martin Luther King's 50 years since he was killed in Memphis. And the conference was in Memphis. And my friend asked me if I could go, but he wasn't able to go, and I didn't want to go by myself. But it was in Memphis, really cool. I got to watch some of this stuff live streaming. And one of the kind of as a delay was actually I didn't watch it live, but one of the sermons that I saw was incredible. Was by Dr. Russell Moore, who is the head of the ERLC, which is the Religious Liberty Commission, Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission. And he was talking about how we as a church still have a long way to go as it relates to race and these kind of things. And as I was looking on his Facebook page, I saw Christians who were telling him basically how wrong he was. And I thought, man, what a painful thing to see the church attacking another Christian because he's standing up for social injustice. When you work to confront these issues, you're going to be hated by many, even those in the church. And so as we think about the gospel and its offense and living out the gospel in our lives, it's certainly going to cause a change in our lives, and it's going to cause people to be offended by the gospel in our lives. But the question is, why? I mean, why are people offended by the gospel? Why? It's good news. That's what the word gospel means. It's good news. How can you be offended by good news? Why do so many people reject this good news? I mean, you could think that grace from God through Christ is so compelling that it's impossible to reject, right? I mean, how do you reject good stuff from God? It just seems crazy, right? Why would anyone even begin to reject the gospel? Well, again, there can't be good news without bad news, right? You can't have, I mean, if there were no bad news, then good news wouldn't exist. Is it on now? Okay, it wasn't on. Thanks, Dean. I've been struggling. I woke up this morning and Carrie was like, what is wrong with you? And I was like, I don't know. I can't breathe. Wasn't able to breathe all last night, but I'm going to make it, right? We're going to make it. If I just quit and walk away, you'll know why, okay? Right, so here's the deal. People reject the good news that God gives grace through Jesus. Why? Well, number one, the reason why they do it, number one, is the nature of God. People reject the good news because of God's nature. God's nature is an affront to humanity. I don't know how many of you have ever considered that, thought about that. It's a big deal. Who God is, though, is counter to who we are. In fact, in Genesis 1:1, we read the very first verse in the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, for most of us, we read that and we go, okay, you know, I've read that 100 times before, no big deal. What's the big deal? It's not offensive at all. How can that be offensive that God created? But think about it. If there is a God and he created everything, then he is in control. God is holy. He's the creator. His very nature determines what is good and right. And what is, in counter to that, the flip side of that, God's nature determines what is wrong as well. And because there is a right and wrong, because there is a good and bad, the wrongdoer must be punished. And God is the judge of that. He delivers justice. Have you ever seen a show or maybe you've been in an actual courtroom where somebody got justice, where they did something wrong, and justice came down, and maybe it was a hard sentence? And have you, I mean, I just imagine this. I've not been in a lot of courtrooms, but I imagine that nobody likes the judge, that or no defendant likes the judge in that moment. Right? Because we love justice as long as it's not coming down on us, right? As long as we're not the ones being confronted with justice. Well, this is the case with God. Because God's justice is perfect, and because he is perfect and he's a good judge, God hates injustice. And so when there's injustice, God responds. And God brings judgment on the wrongdoer. Amos 5:24 says, "But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." Micah 6:8, "He has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God?" Isaiah 61:8, "For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them." People, like I said, God is a God of justice. God loves justice. And people love justice until it's brought on them. And so many people reject the good news of God because they don't want to be judged by God. His very nature requires justice. It's kind of our mantra today. Nobody, you can't judge me, right? Only God can judge me until God does. And then they don't like that either, right? Nobody wants to have justice brought on them. That's one of the reasons why we reject the good news. Why people reject the gospel is because of the nature of God. But we also reject the good news because of the nature of people. You don't have to go very far into the lives of the very first humans to find out why we reject God. And it's because of our desire to be in control. After being tempted by Satan to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, the one thing that God told them they couldn't do, and they went ahead and did it, we see that the nature of people here exists. In Genesis 3:6, we read, "So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate." And so when we read this, we think, well, wait a minute. The tree of knowledge of good and evil, I mean, if they want to know what's right and wrong, what's the big deal about that? But the problem wasn't that Adam and Eve wanted to know the difference between good and evil. They ate of the tree because they wanted a say in the matter. They wanted to be the ones who said, here's what's good and here's what's evil. Here's what's right, here's what's wrong. And you know what? You and I struggle with the same problem. Because when we look at God and we say, even those of us who are Christians, God, I know you said this about that, and I know that you don't want me to do that, and I know, and God, I know, but I'm going to do it anyway. What are we saying? That I want to be the one who decides right from wrong. That's the very nature of humanity. And so by eating the fruit, they're essentially trying to put themselves in God's place. They're trying to be the ones who determine good and evil. And this is the sin that leads to all others. It's the one that says, you can't tell me, I determine for myself. And this is why the message of Jesus is so offensive. It says, you're not in charge of me. I'm not in charge of me. The message of Jesus says, I'm not in charge of me. God is in charge of me. And it's offensive because as people, we worship ourselves over and above God. That's our nature. That's why we reject the gospel. It's why we read in Romans chapter 3. If you have your Bibles, open up to Romans chapter 3. I actually had this in my notes to read to you earlier, but in my coughing fit, I skipped it. Romans chapter 3, if you don't have a Bible, feel free to grab one of those in the pew in front of you. And we're going to be on page 941 in the pew Bible. If you don't own a Bible, we would love for you to take one of those home today as a gift from Snellville Christian Church. And this is the gospel message. And this is Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 21. And Paul writes this to a church in Rome that has both Gentile Christians, those who were never Jewish but became followers of Jesus, and those who are Jewish Christians, those who were followers of the law, but now they're Christians, they're following Jesus. And so there's a conflict in this church, right? And so Paul writes this, Romans 3, verse 21. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Imagine if you're Jewish and you've been living by the law your entire life, and Paul's saying there's a righteousness apart from the law. How offensive would that be? Although the law and prophets bear witness to it, he said, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. This is the offense of the gospel. You and I have fallen short of the glory of God. And Paul goes on to say, and he's talking about all people are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is Christ Jesus, to whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood. That's a weird word, right? It's a church word, propitiation. It means that Christ was an atoning sacrifice. It means that Christ's body was broken by the wrath of God. Why? Because we deserved it. Because justice calls for righteousness, for an act to be done, for punishment to happen. So God brought that punishment on Jesus instead of on us. That's the good news. And in verse 26, it was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just, there's the justice part, and justifier of the one who comes through faith in Jesus. And we reject that. So many people reject that good news, even having seen the empty tomb. We reject that good news. Why? Because of the nature of God. We don't want him in charge of us. And because of our own nature as well. But in the midst of humanity's distaste for the nature of God and for our own nature that elevates self above all else, Jesus steps into humanity. In the midst of us rejecting the gospel, in the midst of us saying, forget you, God, I'm in charge, Jesus comes on the scene. This one who is both God and man, understanding both perspectives, understanding what it is to be God, and at the same time understanding grief and suffering and struggling and temptation to sin. So for God to be righteous and just, he has to condemn the guilty. Who is that? That's everyone who's ever lived except Jesus. Punishment has to come down on humanity because all of humanity has rebelled against God. All of us are guilty and deserving punishment. And some people say this all the time. They'll say things like, well, if God is so good, wouldn't he just let that go? Wouldn't he just forgive us all? I mean, why not? If God's a God of forgiveness, why didn't he just forgive everybody? Why did Jesus have to die? Because he can't do that and still be just. Punishment is required. And so to be just and good, God became a man taking our place on the cross, the place that we deserve. And so this is so offensive to people who reject it. It's why I say we need to work on making sure our bushes are trimmed. It's why we need to work on making sure our parking lot is cleared out. It's why we clean the building. It's because we want to remove every other offense so that when somebody comes in here, they're only offended once, and it's by the gospel of Jesus. And so this is the only way to God is Jesus. That's another offense, right? In Christ, we're asking people to worship a man who died on a cross as a criminal. Can you imagine going to your friend who is a, you know, in business, right? And he or she's, you know, always dresses nice and they're intellectual. And you go to them and you say, hey, I want you to worship Jesus as God and Savior. I mean, yeah, he died a criminal's death, right? I mean, he was found guilty. None of us would ever consider that something that none of us would even put ourselves in that place. How can we worship somebody who's a criminal? So this is another offense, something that trips us up about Jesus. How can God be that guy? And all of that, the nature of God, the nature of people, salvation through Christ, all of that helps us to realize that the gospel is utterly offensive. The gospel is the most offensive part of Christianity. What we think about abortion, the way we dress, the way we interact with people on social media or in the world, how we do whatever, all of those things can be offensive, and frankly, oftentimes they are. But none of those things are the most offensive part of Christianity. The most offensive part is that God became a man and died on our behalf to save us. And so when we do finally come to grips with the truth of the good news of Jesus, we realize that the gospel compels us to action. And this is where I'm getting to, right? As we think about this series, as we think about these issues, the gospel of Jesus compels us to action. If we call ourselves Christians, then we are called to act. We can call ourselves Christians all day long. We can say we follow in the footsteps of Jesus. We can say we're doing our best to be godly people. We can say that we're people who try to adhere to his words. But if we ignore justice, we're nothing more than a clanging cymbal. To follow Jesus means to be like Christ, to take on godly character. And so to not speak is to speak in a big way. To not speak out on injustice is to say all kinds of things about injustice. It's that we don't care. We're not a people holding to the character of God. And we can say we follow God, but if we don't act, then we're not really following God. If we're to be like Jesus, if we're to live lives of godly character, it means that we're to be a people of compassion. Matthew chapter 9, verse 36 said, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Harassed and helpless sounds an awful lot like injustice. We're called to have the same level of compassion that Jesus had. We're called to love God and love people. And I want to tell you, loving people is hard. But loving people means loving everyone. It includes loving somebody whose skin is a different color than your own. It includes loving the refugee or the immigrant who doesn't speak our language. It includes widows and orphans and single moms who have a hard time paying bills. It includes the gay and lesbian in our community. Loving people includes even the self-righteous know-it-all Christian that you want to block on Facebook, you just haven't done it yet. And so my hope is that as we go through this series, you'll examine your views. You'll examine these issues and these thoughts and these things, and you'll begin to take steps to put yourself on the front line of the fight. Not all of us are called by God to act in the same way for the same issues, right? It's why we have a global church. The church doesn't just stop here at Selma Christian Church, praise God, or we wouldn't get very much done. But the church is global, and so each of us have an aspect of the fight that we're called to be in. For some of you, it's going to be one issue. For some of you, it's going to be another. Maybe for some of you, one of the issues we'll discuss will stand at the forefront of your heart and mind, and you'll think, I need to get in that fight. We aren't all called to fight the same way, but we're all called to the fight. Christians are called to stand firm on truth while at the same time expressing the love and grace of God. Now, in that, there is incredible tension. It's hard. Some people won't want to hear the truth. Some who love truth won't want you to act. But it can't be either or. It has to be both and. Either or misses the mark. We're called to express the truth in love, and love requires action. God is a God of grace and truth, and his people should be a people full of grace and truth. as well.